Frederick Douglass, the well-known abolitionist, famously said, "It is easier to build strong children than to repair broken men." Hi, my name is Dr. Rahul Mehra, and I'm an actively practicing physician of over 30 years and the CEO of the National Center for Performance Health. I've been working with children and families and adults in a variety of settings during this time period. We are grateful to be working with Limestone University Athletics on this educational video and hope that you will be able to take some of the points from this and apply it to your everyday life. Mr. Douglass's quote is a powerful reminder that we must be intentional and purposeful in building resilience in our children. If not, long-term consequences will be dire. My thoughts today are intended to focus primarily on providing parents, teachers, and families specific tips on how we can return our children back to school in an emotionally healthy manner against the backdrop of COVID-19. My thoughts are not intended to be a debate on virtual classes versus in-person instruction, but are intended to provide specific strategies to address our collective anxieties. Let's start with introspection. Introspection, while at times not easy, can be a powerful tool for conveying to our children how we overcome adversity and persevere in uncertain times. We can use this historic time to not just maintain, but rather to thrive and transform ourselves. For illustration purposes, and in no way is it my desire to minimize what any one individual is experiencing related to COVID-19. Think for a moment about World War II. In London, the German Air Force engaged in what was called the Blitz, primarily in the years of 1940 and 1941. The German Air Force raided London with explosive bombs 71 separate times. Before the bombing, hundreds of thousands of children in London were evacuated to the countryside to avoid the bombing. Civilians took shelter from the air raids in underground stations. In the Middle East, families and school-aged children are exposed daily to the risk of being bombed. As a reminder, in the United States in the 1950s, school-aged children were taught duck and cover drills, not just for tornadoes, but the potential threat of a nuclear bomb. Now imagine life during the Cold War, and as a parent, sending your child off to school in those circumstances. How we best optimize our coping skills with COVID-19 in terms of returning our children and young adults to formal education boils down simply to our perspective and self-regulation. You mean, Dr. Mehra, that the reports of rising infection rates in my community are a function of my perspective? No, that is not what I'm saying. You and your family can impact personal safety by adequate hand washing, maintaining appropriate physical distancing, and wearing masks when indicated. But you cannot control overall rising infection rates. You cannot control local, state, or federal policies surrounding COVID-19. What you can and should control is your fear, worry, obsession, and anxiety regarding COVID-19. Easier said than done, I fully acknowledge. You must do so. Otherwise, our children's and our young adults' well-being will be compromised. Let us take a closer look at our thoughts, beliefs, attitudes, and emotions. It is our emotions that drive our behavior as humans. Our emotions do not appear out of thin air, but rather are determined by a complex series of three factors: biological, psychological, and social. These three factors are constantly and consistently working in tandem to impact our emotional state of being. This emotional state of being can be positive or negative. How do we change the state of negativity? Or better yet, why should we change being negative and pessimistic? Well, because our lives depend on it. If we don't want to change it for ourselves, we should want to change it for our children and young adults. Because what we think, what we feel, and how we act unequivocally will determine how our students think, feel, and act. How could this be? To get some deeper understanding, let's first more closely examine the biological factors that influence our emotions. Each human inherits a genetic blueprint, like hair color and eye color. The genetic blueprint for how we experience, express, and process emotions really cannot be changed a whole lot. Think of a blueprint for house plans or for building an office complex. This blueprint sets the course for how construction will start. Who we are emotionally is then determined by the construction based on that blueprint. In this analogy, the construction is determined by our relationships and our life experiences. Children and young adults need to grow up feeling safe and secure. These feelings of safety and security will be determined by the primary caregiver's emotional state. COVID-19 represents an enormous emotional challenge for caregivers. How a caregiver responds to COVID-19 will dictate how a child or young adult copes with this stressor. The human brain is the most complex organ we have, but the one we know the least about. Neurons are the cells in our brains that determine how we think, feel, and move. Between the ages of 0 to 3, the brain is processing 1 million new neuronal connections every second. This is the rate at which a toddler is absorbing information. When children and adults encounter stress, fear, or anxiety, like a fire detector, our brains automatically set off a fear detector embedded deep in our brains called the amygdala. When anxiety associated with COVID-19 is ever present in our minds, like a fire detector, the amygdala is rapidly and repeatedly sounding the alarm of impending danger to our brains. Ultimately, through a complex series of neurochemical events, our bodies release cortisol. Cortisol is a chemical that prepares our bodies to fight or flee. It is also called the stress hormone. Repeatedly releasing cortisol is not good for our bodies or minds at any age. This process can and will impair sleep, the capacity to learn, and will weaken our immune systems, making us more susceptible to infection, which is of the utmost concern right now. Our brains are also inherently wired towards negativity. There's a term for it called ANTS, automatic negative thoughts. As adults, we have somewhere between 60,000 and 80,000 thoughts a day. Most are repetitive and many are negative. We must learn to, one, be aware that we have these intrusive thoughts, two, change our thought patterns, and number three, determine the course of action to stop, control, and shift these thoughts to positive thoughts. This bias towards the negative we all share as an adaptive trait of human psychology that served us well when we were hunting with spears in caveman days. It kept us hypervigilant to external threats in our surroundings. Neuroscientist Rick Hansen writes about the strange quality of our brains and provides an analogy. Our brains are like Velcro for negative experiences and Teflon for positive ones. We have spent some time on biological factors that contribute to our emotional state. Let's shift our attention to social factors that contribute to our emotional state. Recall, I said there's an overlap with these three factors. One concept central to understanding human emotions in children and adults is the concept of social referencing. Social referencing is the process by which infants begin using the emotional tones of adult caregivers to regulate their behaviors and emotional reactions toward environmental objects, persons, and situations. Social referencing is one of the major mechanisms by which we make sense of the world around us. As children, we learn how to emotionally react to things by observing and learning nonverbal cues from our families of origin. In other words, if you as a parent are always freaked out, your child will learn directly from you to always be freaked out. This concept extends into adulthood as well. If your boss or supervisor is stressed in a meeting at work, knowingly or unknowingly, you are picking up on social cues and may become stressed yourself. This is how and why stress is contagious. The brain has mirror neurons. Mirror neurons fire both when humans act and when the human observes the same action performed by another. Thus, the neuron mirrors the behavior of the other. Mirror neurons lead us to mimic not just other people's actions, but the intentions and emotions behind those actions. When you see an infant smile, for example, your mirror neurons for smiling fire up, creating a sensation in your mind of the feeling associated with smiling. Watching stress and anxiety in others works the same way, especially if a child is an observer. The third and final contributing factor to emotions is the psychological factor. The exercise of parents, teachers, administrators to be self-aware is vital to success. We must have the insight to identify and articulate specifically what our fears and anxieties are. Only when we clearly and logically identify them can we begin to master them. We have just heard about some of the biological, social, and psychological factors that impact our emotional state. Now what? What can we do next to best help our students and young adults as they return to their learning environments? Here are some specific strategies I call COVID busters. My recommendations are as follows. Number one, adults should limit intake of media coverage about COVID-19 to no more than 15 minutes a day from any source, TV, radio, print, or social media. Monitor how much COVID, if any, related information your children are watching or absorbing. Social media platforms are intentionally designed to keep you engaged. This chronic engagement alters the neurochemistry of your brain and contributes to weakening your resiliency. Be disciplined. Avoid constant head trash. Delete, delete, delete. Number two, uncertainty leads to worry for all of us. However, chronic worrying will not give you more control over the uncontrollable. It robs the pleasure in the present, zaps your energy, and leads to losing sleep. Your children can and do replicate your behavior. Everyone's circumstances are unique. Focus your mind and efforts on taking action over the aspects which are within your control. Like your attitude, your perspective, and your optimistic outlook for the future, it is okay to face your negative emotions. Be honest with yourself. Seek help from friends, family, spiritual advisors, mentors, or professional counselors. Embrace uncertainty. View it as a challenge head on to see how personally you can grow from it. This is an amazing life lesson for children to learn. Number three, as parents, determine a clear plan for the setting for which your child's education will continue in the fall based on the most recent updated medical information. Do not debate the plan in front of your child. This can create anxiety. Certainly check in with your child about how are they feeling. Ask open-ended questions like, what worries you about starting school? Next point, children and young adults need to feel safe and secure. You accomplish this by maintaining a steady emotional state yourself. Provide verbal reassurance that everything is being done to keep everyone safe from COVID-19. Be predictable and consistent. Structure and routine are essential for student success. Communication should be simple, concise, and clear. Use words and concepts children can understand. Next point, do not strive to be the perfect parent. This goal is not achievable. Follow all recommended CDC guidelines, use common sense, and focus on how you and your family can be emotionally healthy. Next point, create robust family conversations. How could we all be better from this? Does this create an opportunity for the family to become closer? Focus on strengths, eliminate negativity. Next point, children and young adults who have pre-existing medical or psychiatric conditions may be at risk for having worsening anxiety, sadness, disruptive behavior, and depression. If you have concerns, contact treating providers in advance before challenges arise. Make sure all medication supplies are up to date and current. Your school district has access to mental health providers that can help support you and your family. Use them. Ask for help early before things become more complex and difficult. Physical distancing does not mean emotional distancing from significant social relationships such as social, civic, and faith-based organizations. Create ways to remain socially connected as school begins. Encourage and be deliberate on how to best re-socialize your children appropriately. Finally, stress is contagious, but so is kindness, compassion, calmness, and optimism. Model these behaviors, and your child will be better for it. We will all thrive and come out on the other side better for it. Please contact us directly at info@nationalcph.com if you would like to enroll in our weekly text updates. We wish you and your family a highly successful school year. All the best.